Please rise. The text for this morning's sermon isn't the gospel lesson which was just read. Rather, it is the lesson just before this morning's gospel lesson. And my friends, you all know this text very well. It reads, "Sovereign Lord, you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people, Israel." Dear friends, this is the word of the Lord from the book of Luke, the Song of Simeon, the Nuknamitis. You may be seated. Dearly beloved of Christ Jesus, the gospel lesson this morning, which we will discuss, is actually the lesson right after the birth of Jesus. But it's just a little delay, though. Just before this, you will hear the text on Tuesday, what happens with our Lord, his circumcision, and his naming. Now, I know I don't have to describe circumcision to most of you, but as you think about it, circumcision involves the spilling of a little blood. Most of you probably remember Bing Crosby. Some of you have no idea who Bing Crosby is. But he had a famous song during this season of the year, which we all know as White Christmas. As we think about the text of this coming Tuesday, and the text today, which also involves sacrifice, we could rename White Christmas to Pink Christmas, because there is a little blood sprinkled in at times. All of this blood, by the way, is a hint for you and for me of the cross of Christ. You've heard over and over again during the season that the Christ child, the Messiah, God made manifest, was born to die. So on Tuesday, you will hear that he spills his blood for the first time, not for himself, but to fulfill the law. Today, you will hear that there was another sacrifice to be given, a sacrifice which was required by the law so that Jesus could be redeemed. Just before the sacrifice was given, as Joseph and Mary were ascending the steps into the temple area, they are met by an old man, and his name is Simeon. Also coming up is an old woman. Her name is Anna. Here we have two senior citizens about to proclaim the gospel. These two senior citizens were living in the temple. Isn't it ironic that they were living in the temple as they were awaiting the temple of God? The sermon which you heard on Christmas morning. Yes, Jesus is the temple of God, not made with human hands, but incarnated by the power of the Holy Spirit. And here we have two senior citizens waiting to see their redemption, waiting to see their Messiah. We could say that they were believers. They heard the promise of God and they believed. Therefore, they were given special favor by God. Two senior citizens given favor by God. My friends, I know that in this congregation there are many aged. With age comes wisdom. With age also comes infirmities. With age also comes the loss of a spouse, either a husband or a wife. I know that during this season of the year, it's very difficult for those who are without husband or without wife. You remember those times of Christmases past, of all the joy that your husband or your wife brought, not only to you, but to your family. We see in this text that even as two aged members of Israel were awaiting the Messiah, they heard the word of God and they believed. So we in this congregation, who are without husband or without wife, we too must have faith, believing that we too will see the Messiah, and we will also see our loved one again. That is his promise. Simeon believed the promise. Anna believed the promise. Dear ones of Christ Jesus, believe the promise. You will soon see your Messiah, and you will soon see your loved one again. So Jesus is at the temple. The temple has come to the temple. And there he is to be, presented to the priest. Now this presentation of Jesus is in accordance with the law. We find it in Leviticus chapter 12. That the firstborn who opened the womb of a woman belonged to God. And the only way that this child could be redeemed is for two doves or for two pigeons to be sacrificed, especially by the poor. Well, Mary and Joseph were two poor people. So they sacrificed, as was required, two doves to, isn't this ironic, to redeem Jesus? This redemption of Christ happened 33 days after his circumcision. We stop and think about it. Many believe that Jesus redeemed the world in his 33rd year. You see how God works? God is a God of order, but he's also a God of surprises. Jesus was redeemed 33 days after he was given birth. And he redeemed the world in his 33rd year of life. At the temple, we know we see the old man, Simeon. Simeon believed the promise, as you heard. He believed that before he died, he would see the Messiah. That was a promise given to him, and he believed. So therefore, in fulfillment, when he saw the Christ child, he sings a very famous song, the song which I just read to you, a song which each and every one of you sing after you see the fulfillment of his promise. Now, I know what you're thinking. Pastor, I don't see the fulfillment of a promise when I sing this song. And the answer is, oh, yes, you do. My friends, after communion, after you receive the Lord's body and blood, we sing the Nunc Dimittis. You sing it because you have just seen, and you have just touched, and you have just eaten. You have just drank the fulfillment of the Lord. His promise that he would never leave you. His promise that he would give to you his body and blood for the forgiveness of your sin. Therefore, that's why in the church we sing this song. It is a song of fulfillment. It is also a song of promise. You see, Simeon recognized his Messiah. When you receive here at this altar, you're also seeing your Messiah. As Simeon was talking with Mary and Joseph, he says something, actually a number of things are quite astounding. He tells Mary that her son will be the rising and falling of many in Israel. Well, what does that mean to us? How do we apply that in our lives? Well, my friends, stop and think about it. Jesus, the rising of many in Shum, and the falling of many in Shum. We all know that the cream rises to the top. My friends, the believer will rise on the great last day, and they will enter into his kingdom. But also we know that the unbeliever will too rise. But they are not the cream. They are the dregs. They will drink the cup of wrath, and therefore they will fall. The falling of many, condemnation of their Lord, because they refuse to believe, because they refuse to see the fulfillment of their Messiah. And that's how we apply it to our lives. In our lives today, none of you, of course, but there are members of your family who have fallen away, but each of you have risen to the top. You have risen to believe that Jesus is the Messiah. But then there are those who have fallen away. It's time to speak the gospel in love. It's time to tell them that the time of decision is now. Either you will rise or you will fall. Notice that there's no middle ground. Simeon also says that he will also be a sign to be spoken of and to be spoken against, thus revealing the thoughts of the hearts. The thoughts of the hearts. Those who speak against Jesus are revealing what they truly believe about the Messiah. It's not unlike the days when Jesus stood before Pilate, when he stood before the high priest in the Sanhedrin, when he was marched out to Golgotha and nailed to a cross. Those people were revealing their thoughts that Jesus was not the Messiah. But you, my dear friends, are revealing in your hearts that you believe that he is the Messiah. Then Simeon says something that's a little confusing. He looks at Mary and says, "Then a sword will pierce your very soul." As Jesus hung on the cross, we know that a spear pierced into his heart. Here Simeon says that her soul will be pierced. As you recall, there were people at the crucifixion of Jesus, people that knew him very well. One of those was his mother. And as Mary stood there, "Moms, can you envision this? Your son has been viciously whipped. He has had a crown of thorns, not placed on his head, but beaten onto his head. And then the ultimate of ultimate, he is marched to the place of execution. There he is stripped naked and nailed to a cross and hung up so all to see. There your son is hanging from a tree. The blood is pouring off of him. And a sword pierces Mary's heart." As Simeon was saying these words, an old woman walks up. Her name is Anna. She's been living in the temple for a very long time. And she too proclaims that Jesus is the promised Messiah. An old man, an old woman, proclaiming the gospel. They both did this because of the power of the Holy Spirit. You see, my friends, it's not by our power that we proclaim the gospel. It is God speaking through us. The Holy Spirit will always move those to confess that Jesus is the Savior, that he is the Messiah. So as you sit there thinking, "Well, I'm an old man or I'm an old woman, and therefore I can't speak the gospel, I can't even live the gospel." Yes, you can, because the Holy Spirit will work through you and he will speak through you. All you have to do is believe, as did Simeon, and believe, as did Anna. So we now close. We close with these great words of Simeon: "Behold, my eyes have seen your salvation." Actually, my friends, we could change this to say, "Behold, your eyes have seen your salvation." And you do see it. You have seen the salvation of the Lord in your very life. Many of you were baptized at this font, salvation by the Lord. Many of you stood at this altar and confessed that Jesus is your Savior. Confession, salvation. Many of you, many, many times have stood at this altar and received and have drunk his blood. Salvation. Yes, you do see his salvation. You see it over and over and over again. Therefore, you are without excuse. But my friends, the unbeliever is also without excuse. For they truly know in their heart who Jesus is, but they choose to turn away. They choose to follow their own self-righteousness. And in their self-righteousness, they will be condemned. But you, his children, each and every one of you, as you stand here, as you hear the preached word, you believe, and in your belief, all your sins are forgiven. Forgiven by the one who has revealed to you his salvation. Thanks be to Jesus. Thanks be to Jesus indeed. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.